Welcome to Questions for Christians. My name is Bernie Dehler, and I'm a former evangelical born-again Christian. I'm now an atheist. In this series, I talk to various Christians that are active in ministry to have a discussion on various important topics of theology and science. My guest today by phone is Dennis Marcellino. Hi, Dennis.
Hi.
Dennis, would you give maybe 60 seconds to explain who you are to people who have never heard your name before?
Okay, well, I've written a number of books. I used to be, I guess, agnostic, you'd call it. I wasn't interested in God at all. I was just kind of like a worldly person. And then I got into the music business and became a member of some famous bands. But I also have a degree in engineering and psychology. And 33 years ago, I really got heavily interested into Christianity and the Bible. And so, you know, so but of course I didn't want to be into something that could prove to be not true. So so I've spent a lot of years, you know, applying my engineering sensibility to seeing if it is true or not. And it's proven to me to be true.
Okay, and then while we're talking, I'm going to have on the screen some of the books you've written and some of your web pages and things like that, so the audience will get a feel for that. So on this show, I have five different sections, and then we're going to have a wrap-up session. So let me, each section is going to be 10 minutes, too, so let me set the timer here. So the first, okay, let me go over overview of the five sections. The first section is going to be the question, how should we interpret the Adam and Eve story in light of modern science? The second one is, how should we interpret the Noah's Ark story in light of modern science? The third one is morality grounded in God? The fourth question is, can one feel the presence of God? And the fifth one is, why is there something rather than nothing? That the universe even exists, is it evidence for the existence of God? And then we're going to have a little wrap-up after that. So to start off the first 10 minutes, let me put my timer on here. So we're going to start with, how should we interpret the Adam and Eve story in light of modern science? And basically the intention here is to have like a 50-50 dialogue. So, Dennis, do you believe that there was really a historical person named Adam and Eve?
Yeah.
Okay, now, so, and you don't accept modern, so let me just say this, in modern evolutionary theory, there is no such thing as a first human or a first rabbit or a first anything, because all species evolve over time and within a population. So there's never a first of anything. There's a gene pool and all that. But you don't accept evolution, right?
So, right.
So how do you... So basically, why don't you just briefly tell me what your position is on Adam and Eve then? You believe that basically God just made them? How did God make Adam and Eve?
Well, just the way it says in the Bible. I mean, obviously neither of us was there. We don't have any video footage or anything. So so what we have to go on is basically science and the Bible. And when I say the Bible, I don't mean to just blindly accept it. I mean, I wrote a book called The Proof, and then that God exists in the Bible is true. And so I've heavily studied that, you know, the Bible can be backed up as a book of truth, both from the science standpoint and from many other viewpoints, actually. So so I guess what it comes down to is we have a choice, you know, as to whether to accept evolution, the theory of evolution, or not, or the Bible. And you know, being that I found that science actually backs the Bible and not evolution, because, you know, like, for instance, there are millions of fossils, and yet there aren't any transitional forms. They can't be disproven as either being a hoax or, you know, or unscientific. So, like, you know, animals, in other words, that they're calling man forms that are really animals. So so that leaves me with two options as far as, like, you know, what to decide. And so being that science is not on the side of evolution and science is on the side of the Bible, then science and logic would say that I should abandon the theory of evolution until some proof comes along. you know, in the meantime, the evidence in the book, The Proof, shows that there is a lot of proof that the Bible and its accounts of origins are true.
Okay, well, let's back up a little bit. So one thing I hope we can talk about is you said there's no evidence for evolution, and I would say one evidence I think is extremely compelling is what they call genomic evidence, the evidence in the DNA. But I want to back up and we could talk about that, but I want to back up again. So you said you believe that in the first humans as the Bible portrays it. So the Bible literally says that God scooped dirt or the mud or whatever and formed man and then breathed life into it. So do you think that's literally how it happened? Like, in other words, if you had a videotape at that time, that's what you would have actually seen and the way it's recorded?
Right. I mean, that's not a preposterous thing to envision or think, because, I mean, what about the universe? Physical universe itself was created. That's a miracle right there. So, you know, why couldn't God do it any way that he wanted to?
So what about all the other animals, like, for example, a whale, for example? Do you think God basically made that like a poof, you know, there was no whale and all of a sudden there was a whale, kind of a poof kind of thing?
Right.
So basically the animals kind of poofed into existence, all the animals?
Yes, a poof.
Okay. Now, what would you say about... I guess in my opinion, most Christians would disagree with that. What do you think?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I think just the opposite. There's no reason really to take the Bible other than literal. If you're going to be into the Bible.
Well, what do you think about, like, William Lane Craig, for example? He's like one of the most famous Christian debaters, and, you know, he would definitely not go for this, you know, proof, you know?
Well, then he's not into the Bible. It's that simple.
Okay, so like maybe Ken Ham might agree with you, and he's actually a young Earth creationist. So your view would be like with Ken Ham?
I wouldn't say exactly what he does, because there's just some things I disagree that he does. But just on
human origins, it would be the same pretty much that you think?
Yeah, he believes it, but you know, I have proof backing it up more so than him. He starts with a biblical worldview. That's what he says. You either start with the biblical worldview or a naturalistic worldview. Mm. But I say, no, you can't just start there. You have to bridge the gap between logic and science to get to that point.
Okay, now you say there is no evidence at all for evolution, but you know, we've had numerous debates and things, and I always bring up there is a lot of evidence. There's genomic evidence. But that always seems to kind of roll off. You just roll right off.
Restate your proof there.
Well, one of the most famous arguments, I guess, are pseudogenes, where it's obvious that we have inherited broken genes that other animals, according to descent, have, and we have busted copies.
I'm still not tracking with that. So.
Well, the pseudogene argument. So you're not familiar with the pseudogene argument then?
No. I know about the genome, but go ahead.
Okay, so basically if you compare all the animals across, for example, all mammals, and for example, one would be the insulin gene. That's not the pseudogene argument. That's just similarity. So basically... the vitamin C one is one, ascorbic acid, where we cannot synthesize vitamin C, where other mammals can, and according to descent, and you can see where we actually have, the reason why we can't is because our gene is chopped up, and it's not functional, and this is why we have to eat vitamin C or we get scurvy. But some other mammals do have it, and we can see, for example, that, you know, like us and the gorillas, the gorillas, for example, yeah, they have the same, I can't remember if they have the same problem or not, but at some point, like dogs and cats, you know, they don't have this problem. And so if you look at evolutionary trees and see where we came from, you can see that those, according to descent, they have the gene that works. And we have thousands and thousands of busted genes. For example, in the olfactory sense, our sense of smelling, we have all these smelling genes for smelling, you know, detecting odors, but they're busted. And, you know, other animals, like dogs, for example, they're not busted with them.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of differences between us and animals, and there's a lot of things that animals can do that we can't do. You know, chameleons could change colors. Dogs have to live, in the wild. Mm-hmm. They have to live off of things that we couldn't live off of, and they have to process them. So they need, you know, extra abilities.
But according to this argument, if you have an evolutionary tree of descent, and what you can see is, you can see the pattern of how an ancestor has genes that work, and the descendants gradually drop those genes. And the genes are dropped according to descent. And so the farther along descent, the more genes are dropped. So there's a sequential progression of broken genes. And so if there is no descent, then it's like, you know, if God really did create people individually, then it's like he misled scientists to plant the evidence to make it look like there was a descent. So what I'm saying is, you can tell as the descent happens, the genes get more and more busted.
Well, you know, that's one way of looking at it. I don't think that's the case. Like I said, animals have needs, you know, as far as like processing food and stuff like that, that we don't have. And so that's the reason we don't need them.
Okay, so we have about one more minute. What would you like to finish up on this topic about Adam and Eve?
Let's see. Well, I guess there's nothing really more to say. You know, I mean, regarding evolution, you know, Darwin even called his theory of evolution the devil's gospel. So he knew what he was getting into there. And he also said if he knew what we knew now that he wouldn't have put forth that theory. It's got to remember, it's a theory.
Okay, so scientific theory, though, is different than somebody just saying, I have a theory. A scientific theory entails a whole bunch of laws and facts and bundles them all together for a theory. So it's not just a theory like somebody has a hunch kind of theory. It's a scientific theory, which is different than a person's opinion.
Right, I agree.
So like people, when they say it's just a theory, they're usually misrepresenting what a scientific theory is.
Let me say one other thing, too, about because I did prove the Bible, is the Bible's standpoint that there was a first man and a first woman, and there was no death before that. God's initial intention was that humans would live as humans forever. So if there was evolution, well, then there had to be death mm-hmm. before the Bible, the way the Bible says.
Right. Right, and some people have said too that, well, the original creation had to include death, otherwise the original creation wouldn't have been good. God said God created creation, and before it fell, he said it was good, but it wouldn't be good unless it was sustainable. And if there was no death, it wouldn't be sustainable because creatures would be reproducing and there would be no room to hold everything.
Well, he did say, though, to replenish the earth. You know, as it turned mm-hmm. out, there death came into existence, but the original intention wasn't there.
Okay, well, that's the complaint, though. If it's not in the original design, then it wouldn't have been sustainable.
Yeah, I don't think so, because, like, for instance, you know, there's always a complaint about overpopulation in the world. Yet if you do the math, say my house is 1,132 square feet. So if you do the math, you can give 1,132 square feet to 7 billion people, and it would all fit in the state of Texas. So that's pretty sustainable.
Okay, well, we got to leave it on there because we're out of time on this one. So let's go to the next one. And this next one might be a little bit shorter because I need to catch up on time.
Okay.
So this is what, on Noah's Ark. Do you believe that there was literally a worldwide flood about 6,000 years ago?
Right.
I mean, the obvious question is, how can you believe this in light of modern science? Because it seems like it's so easy to disprove scientifically.
Well, that's actually not the case. Louis Pasteur said, and he's the father of microbiology, a top scientist, he said that a little bit of science brings us to God, averts us from God, but a lot of it brings us back to him. And so let me just say that recently in Science magazine, they found a pool of, I mean, oceans of water, three times the size of the oceans on the Earth, about 400 miles deep into the Earth. And so what the Bible says, it says fountains from the deep provided the water for the flood. And then it receded back in, and it says that too in the Bible.
Well, it says the springs opened up, and also it said the floodgates of heaven opened up. Now, my understanding is in that ancient Hebrew cosmology, they actually literally thought there was a heavenly ocean up in the sky. That's why the sky is blue up there. And why wouldn't all that water come crushing down on us? Well, it's because there was a firmament that protected us. And in that firmament, there was floodgates, and those floodgates were opened. And so the heavenly waters, you know, came out and, you know, basically filled the earth. So, well, I mean, obviously nobody believes that there's any kind of floodgates up there. There's no firmament anymore.
No, I mean, that's a whole other thing. But the water, the canopy theory. But no, the Bible actually says that fountains from the deep sprung forth, and that's where the water came from.
Well, if the water came from the earth, then are you saying it would come from the earth, from the center of the earth, somehow like get pumped out, and there'd be a big void in the earth? I mean, it seems like the earth would collapse if there was a big void there.
Not necessarily. You have caves and caverns.
But all the water, you're saying all the water is in the earth and it's getting pumped out to the exterior.
Right.
So there'd be a big vacuum then where that water used to be.
No, the water went back, obviously, because we're not flooded right now. So.
No, yeah, but while the flood was going on, all the water is pushed out of those caverns. So all of that water is now removed. It's like a empty cup in there. It seems like Earth's gravity would just make everything collapse.
No, not necessarily. It doesn't do that with caves. And the Bible said, to me, this is another example of how science is catching up with the Bible rather than disproving it. And, and that this has been proven in Science magazine by a number of scientists, that there is that three times the amount of oceans on the Earth in this cavern 400 miles deep.
Now, what about the obvious thing, too? People bring up, if you believe in a worldwide flood, I mean, there's two huge problems. One is the biodiversity that we see. To think that there were like penguins on the ark, and how would they stay on the ark? Because according to the Bible, they were on the ark for over a year or about a year. And, everything needs a miracle because you only have two of a certain kind. I mean, these animals, what would you be feeding lions? I mean, there's no prey to feed them.
Sure. Well, before the flood, everybody was vegetarian. And so, so probably on the ark, by the way, it wasn't just two of a kind, it's like five to seven of a kind. And they could have mm-hmm. been babies, and the ark was pretty big too, because they're recreating it right now in Cincinnati.
So for example, in the fossil record, there's a brontosaurus and T-Rex. So those would have been on the ark?
Yeah. They would have been babies, though.
Okay, and T-Rex and alligators and lions, all these carnivores were vegetarians at that time.
Yeah, and it could have been eggs, too, not just babies.
Well, it says they walked to the ark, right? God guided them to the ark, so they couldn't have been eggs.
Okay, yeah, you got me there.
Okay, but I mean, even if there was like seven of each, I mean, still, I mean, that just magnifies the problem because now you got more food to have to feed all these animals.
Yeah, well, maybe some of them were food, though, became food. Mm.
Well, the other thing, too, is like when you look at Australia, there's all kinds of marsupials over there. They're saying like, according to evolution, there was a lot of marsupial evolution over there, like there's marsupial like kangaroos and even tigers. There's no marsupial tigers in North and South America, for example, or Africa, I guess, because there was a different kind of evolutionary process.
Well, let me make it clear, though, when we talk about evolution, I'm talking about macroevolution, mm-hmm. not microevolution.
Right.
There is definitely microevolution. Things do evolve in that way to adapt to their environment. But there's just no macroevolution of going from one kind to another.
Mm-hmm. So for example, the penguins. I mean, somehow the penguins, how would the penguins get to the ark? I mean, is this just a miracle? That's the only way to explain it?
Oh, you mean how did they get there if there was water in between?
Well, there's all these animals that are in different habitats that would not be able to tolerate the kind of habitat where the ark was being built. So, you know, extreme temperature, there's animals that live in extreme temperatures, like polar bears, for example. How would these animals that live in extreme temperatures get to the ark, and then how would they get back to where they're going?
Well, you know, the land mass probably was connected. I mean, if you look at the map of the world, it does look like, you know, a puzzle where, you know, Africa fits onto South America and, you know, on and on.
So, like, penguins would... Okay, let me ask you another question. Another thing that people bring up, they go, well, you know, obviously, there's a lot of fish that live only in salt water or fresh water. And if you mix the salt and the fresh water, because that's what happens in a worldwide flood, that would destroy all kinds of fish.
Well, they could have evolved to being salt water or fresh water. I mean, it was probably all salt water back then, I would imagine. And so they could have evolved to freshwater fish, or it might have been the other way around.
Okay, so yeah, so basically you're seeing all the data through a different set of lens, because you think the Earth is only about 10,000 years old or so, or 6,000 years old or something like that, or
right.
8,000 years old or something?
Instead of
like 4 billion years old, I believe.
Right, there's so much proof against that, yeah.
Okay, is there anything else you want to say about Noah's Ark before we move on?
No, that's okay. I mean, you said we had a cut time there, so.
Okay. So the next section I want to talk about is morality. The reason why I'm bringing this up is because a lot of, in Christian atheist debates, a lot of Christians say that atheists have no basis for morality. They say that, you know, if atheists want to debate or want to stand for morality, they're basically stealing from the Christian worldview. That's a very common saying. So let me give just a brief overview of what I believe about morality, and then I'll let you talk and explain what you see it. The way I see it is it's morality is very simple to understand the basis of it is. I mean, exactly what's a moral issue or the moral answer can be difficult, but here's the basic understanding of morality. Basically, morality is all about human flourishing, community flourishing. You want to make laws and have behavior. It's all about behavior, what's good for a community. And a good analogy is a map. A map, for example, is directions to a certain place. So, for example, if I said, how do I get to Fred Meyer's? There's a certain path that is optimum. And maybe there's an accident, and then the path to that Fred Meyer's would be a different path. But the goal is to get that target, which get that location. And so if you go the opposite way, that's actually a bad plan or a bad map. And if you go the most direct way, that's a good map. And so likewise, for community, building a good community, there's things to do to have a good community. For example, if you say raping and killing is fine, then that's going to destroy your community. That's bad. If you say, for example, helping those in need, giving people hugs, helping people with their homework or whatever, those are good things because it helps the community flourish. So that's why it's easy to, that's the basis for morality is what leads to community flourishing. And immorality is basically things that hurt. So usually whenever there's a moral question, like what's the right thing to do in this situation, you just think about what would be the best for the community. So that's my explanation. I'd like to know what your response is, and you can also explain what you think morality is if you have a different idea.
Okay, well, no, I would basically agree with what you just said. I would just take it in a step further. See, basically, from the engineering perspective, these bodies that we're in, they were designed to optimally work a certain way. And, of course, in between people also, there's an optimum working, and you kind of included that in what you just said. But then there's God, though, and his intention of what he was trying to create here. And so he was trying to create something, a very high sense of love and experience. And so in that sense, then, yeah, we can't do anything that would hurt another person. So it even gets more refined when you take on the of the God perspective to what you just described.
Okay, well, sometimes people, in moral philosophy, there's a lot of different standards. And for example, the kind of standard I brought up, it could be called utilitarianism or consequentialism. But let me clarify. I believe there's actually three pillars to use for criteria for determining if something's moral. One is reciprocity, which means do to others what you would want them to do to you. Another one is consequentialism, which means trying to look at the outcome to see what's going to result from that. And you have to use your imagination because it hasn't happened yet. You have to simulate it in your mind. And the third one is individual free rights. So on any question, you can use those three things. Like, for example, should marijuana be legal? Well, you look on reciprocity, that doesn't really apply on that one, I don't think so much. Consequentialism is, well, this is where one might argue, well, if we legalize marijuana, it could result in, you know, a lot of accidents or people destroying their lives. And somebody else might say, you know, it would improve their life, especially if they have illnesses or something. Some other people might say, hey, it's a good way to enjoy life, taking some legal drugs. And then the other one is individual rights. So for example, the idea there is as long as it doesn't hurt anybody, then people are free to do what they want to do. So, you know, if you want to do it and you're not causing trouble or it's not going to hurt anybody else, then what you do in your private time is fine. So how would you figure out, like, if marijuana, you know, that's a moral issue, should marijuana be legal in Oregon or not? How do you determine what the right moral answer is on that?
Well, let's see. Did God create marijuana?
Yeah. You know,
there you go. So he created it.
Huh? So your answer is he created it, so yes, it's okay?
Yeah, I mean, it's just there are a lot of different things that could be that could fall under your excess, you know. And so, yeah, if excess causes people to be so stoned that they can't drive well, then that's a problem. So, but, you know, there's many religions, like, you know, the Indians and the peace pipe.
Yeah, and peyote also. I mean, it's a hallucinogenic drug.
Right.
So you have the same opinion that as long as it doesn't really hurt anybody, it's fine because God made it?
Yeah, and it might even help. I come from being a hippie, and so obviously I was a musician, so obviously I tried marijuana. and what it did for me was it relaxed me to the point where I said, wow, why don't I feel this way all the time? Mm-hmm. And that inspired my whole search into psychology and religion.
And what about cocaine then, for example?
Yeah, cocaine's bad.
Well, but it's the same thing. God made it, didn't he?
No, he made the coca plant, but he didn't make refined cocaine. That has to go through.
Well,
a
he made the but he made the marijuana plant. But it, you know, we had to smoke it
or eat it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess you could just eat it. That's true. I was gonna say you have to cook it, but I guess you could eat it raw if you want salad.
Right. Sure, people used to put it in spaghetti and all that, and brownies and.
One thing to beware of, though, there's a called a naturalistic fallacy, where some people say if it's natural, it's good. But then, you know, the counterpoint to that is, well, you know, uranium is natural. It's radioactive. It'll kill you.
And poison mushrooms.
Yeah. So, I mean, is your argument that if you could eat it, then it's fine?
I mean, yes, right, too. It's a spice. If you look at it as a spice, I mean, there are a lot of things that people eat, like jalapenos and stuff that I can't handle. Uh-huh. That could be, you know, harmful to the digestive tract and all that.
That's interesting. I never heard that argument before. So if it's a drug and you can eat it, then it should be fine.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, it's like I said,
in moderation.
Mushrooms.
What about mushrooms?
You know, poison mushrooms.
Oh, what about the psilocybin mushrooms?
Yeah, that's...
Those are good?
Yeah.
Yeah, those are... I'm not
proposing that these things are good, because I've had some of the worst times of my life on that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but God made it, though, so... Interesting. I'm not clear on your answer. So, like, let's say, for example, psychedelic mushrooms. That's good in moderation, you're saying? That's okay?
I guess I'd have to think about it. I've had some of the best nights of my life on them, and I've had some of the worst nights of my life on them, which caused, years of damage, years of emotional damage and psychological damage.
So how do you determine morality if another Christian says to you, like, no drugs at all, I mean, like, the Mormons are very extreme. They don't even want to drink hot drinks, I think, which, basically is like caffeine. They don't even want to drink coffee or something. So, I mean, if a Christian says to you, no, it's against God's law to take drugs at all because it puts you in a different state of mind, how do you say, like, well, no, that's not God's law? I mean, how do you figure out what God's law is or God's morality on
Well, I
that?
think this gets into your third leg then, personal experimentation. We should have freedom for that. And like, I don't even, I mean, Jesus made wine at the wedding, and even the Bible says wine makes your heart merry. But I don't drink wine, I don't drink anything, and I don't take any drugs. I haven't done so for many years. I don't feel the need for them. So, that there's the interpretation, intellectual interpretation, but then there's also the physical reality, and that's what my physical reality has led me to.
Yeah, I know some Baptists, or maybe even most or many of them, I don't know, but a lot of them, they don't drink wine at all. And it's like you said, Jesus turned water into wine at the wedding. And it's like, well, that's because their water wasn't, I don't know, it's like they don't want to admit it, and it's like.
No, I know. I've been through that. Some people say it's grape juice, and but no, it's definitely wine, because the Bible talks a lot about excess with wine. Don't get drunk,
Yeah, and they said, according to the parable, it says that, or the story, it says it was the best wine too. So,
Right, there you go.
okay, so let's go on to the next one. The next section is, can you feel the presence of God? This comes up in Christian atheist debates. People say, a lot of times, a Christian will say to an atheist, "Well, you know what? Maybe you just got to try God. You just got to try Jesus, and just try it and see what you think." You'll never understand. I mean, it's not a matter of arguing you into the kingdom of God. You got to feel a personal relationship, and having a personal relationship with Jesus is like having a personal relationship with your spouse. And just as you wouldn't doubt a personal relationship with your spouse, you shouldn't doubt this personal relationship with Jesus. Well, I was a Christian. I was born again evangelical Christian. I believe I felt exactly what the Christians feel when they say they have a personal relationship with Jesus. I felt like I was led by God. I prayed for guidance. I believe that any Christian that says they are led by God or communicates with God or has a presence of God, I believe I had that, and I now consider it a delusion, the God delusion. And I want to say also, I think it's a logical fallacy that there's a fallacy called appeal to emotion, where you say basically your emotions cannot determine reality or what the truth of a thing. So, for example, if you have a guy on trial for being a murderer, but this guy looks really nice in a suit and he's very charismatic, you don't want to say, "Oh, that guy's such a nice guy. He couldn't have murdered people." The way he presents himself, your feelings, they cannot determine whether this guy is guilty or not. You have to look at the evidence. And so, in the same way, you cannot have feelings for God and say this is evidence that God exists. So that's my position. I'd like to hear what your response is.
Okay, well, yeah, that's your experience, and I'll just tell you mine. Basically, Psalm 4:4 says to sit on your bed in silence and ponder your heart. Okay, so I did that as a formal practice, at least an hour in the morning and an hour at night for about 5 years. And what I can say is my experience with that is when you go inside, if you silence your mind, which is a very, chatty creature, you start experiencing more and more an increasing peace and an increasing clarity. If you're not thinking about something, you're seeing it. So, but then the more that you get into that, that increase keeps increasing. And it comes to the point where you go into states of bliss, and even then ecstasy. And the greatest experiences I've had in my life have been in those states. And so, and when you're in those states, all you're doing is just kind of, I call it internal silent observation. If you're doing it as a scientist, say, you end up seeing that there's a presence inside of your, deep inside of your heart. I mean, some people call it the sixth sense. Some people call it intuition. But it's a presence. You can feel the presence. And when you're in it, you know it's God. And so, I mean, I highly recommend that to everybody, because what happens is when you're walking through life, that presence doesn't go away. So harmony with that presence leads you to the best possible life and ways to approach life.
But what do you think about what I said, where I felt that presence? I know the presence you're talking about, and I have to conclude that it's a delusion to conflate that with that God exists, because there is no evidence. There's no good evidence for the existence of God. Therefore, it has to be a delusion.
Okay,
there's people of all kinds of religions that you would say their religion is obviously wrong, and yet they say they also experience God. You know, for example, Muslim or Hindus.
Yeah, I don't say they're wrong, and neither does, like, say, the Catholic Church, for instance.
You do say they're wrong, because, for example, Muslims would not say that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, and
now you're getting into a mental area, though. See, that's a mental conclusion. Even your delusion conclusion is a mental conclusion. But what I'm talking about is the experiential reality, and people in other religions do experience God. Do experience that reality. Now, when they take it into mental conclusions, that's where the problems happen.
But they're getting these messages from God, or these insights, these profound ideas, and they're writing them down as inspirations. I can't remember the word for it. When you epiphany, they're getting these epiphanies. They're obviously from God, because they're so powerful and effective. And yet these epiphanies of different religions conflicted with each other.
Yeah, I would question if they're epiphanies or not. Because there's only one God and there's only one truth. So, you know, but the Bible says, it says that God is love. So when you're experiencing love in your heart, and anybody can experience that throughout the world, you're experiencing God. And it also says that God wishes that none should perish. So I think he's made an effort with every human being at one point in their life to reveal himself to them, and the opportunity to be idealistic on his level.
Well, let me tell you something. When I was an evangelical Christian, I met with some Mormons, and they said, basically, in the Book of Mormon, it says to pray about the Book of Mormon, and that if pray to God to give you a burning in the bosom, if it is true or not. And I did. I prayed with an open heart. And what happened was I did get the burning in the bosom. And this is the thought process. I was a Mormon for about 5 seconds, because this is what happened. I got the burning in the bosom. I got the feeling. And I thought, oh, I guess I'm a Mormon now. And then my next thought was, Bernie, how could you be a Mormon with what you know? And it's like, and I said, yeah, you're right. Because I knew too much, because I studied the history and all that. So that's an example of getting the feeling from a prayer. It's a spiritual feeling, but it's a delusion. It's wrong. It's not. It can't be from God, because the Book of Mormon, we both agree, the Book of Mormon is fiction, right?
I don't know. I've never studied it, but I imagine so. I've never studied it. I know that I've stayed in Salt Lake City for a while, and the people there were much more advanced in terms of morality than most of America. So I have to give them that credit. But I don't know. You're entering into like a mental way of evaluating things. And so I'm saying,
I know, but see, if I just followed my heart, I would have been a Mormon. I would have said, it doesn't make sense to me, but I have to follow my heart. And then I would try to convert you to Mormonism. And what would you say to me? I'd say, look, Brother Dennis, I got the feelings. You can't argue with that, right?
Yeah, but you, when you say try to convert me, that means you're going through an intellectual thing of presenting facts to me that are either convincing or not, et cetera, et cetera.
No, I would probably ask you to do what I did and pray about the Book of Mormon and see if God reveals it to you.
Yeah, well, I did read part of the Book of Mormon, by the way, and it just looked like, you know, just a bunch of gibberish, you know, meaningless stuff. See, here's my thing as far as religion goes. My whole thing is to have a direct relationship with God. And he revealed himself literally in the Bible, but he's also experientially in our heart. And that's as far as I take it. I mean, I don't promote any religion or any kind of, you know, like rules that people make up. If it's in the Bible, great. If it's not, you know, then I
okay. So you're saying that you can use your feelings, that you have the presence of God, you can use that as evidence to know that God exists. And I'm saying that's a logical fallacy. You cannot determine if things exist by your feelings. And so
I agree.
We just have a disagreement there. Is that right?
No, I agree with you. But I'm saying that you take it further. And then you delve in. I mean, I delved into the Bible. I mean, part of my testimony is I tried 20 approaches to lifestyle and truth before coming to the Bible. None of them worked as far as giving me peace and clarity and deep fulfillment. Mm-hmm. When I hit the Bible, that worked. And that's been going on for 33 years now. And, you know, I've scrutinized it, you know, from an engineer's training, you know, intellectually. But mm-hmm. also, you know, the Bible says in 1 John 2:27, it says that you've been gifted with the Holy Spirit, and that will lead you into all truth. You're not in need of a teacher. So that worked for me, and it's worked for 33 years.
Okay, so let's leave it there since we're out of time on this segment and go to the next one. We're making some pretty good time here. Okay, I'm just working on my timer here.
Okay.
Okay, so the last section is, why is there something rather than nothing? The reason why I brought this up is because this is a main topic usually in atheist and Christian debates. They'll say that, you know, it just doesn't make sense that everything popped into existence from nothing. You need a God to create all this. And I think, you know, actually there's two possible answers. One possible answer, and the problem is that neither one of these possibilities makes sense to us humans. One possible answer is that something always existed. The other possibility is that something came out of nothing. And we do not understand either one of those situations because we don't experience that in our lifetimes. But those seem to be the only two possible answers. And so, personally, I think logically the answer is that there's something always existed, because I don't believe that something can pop out of nothing.
Exactly.
Now just for some of my fellow atheists, they'll say, well, you know, Lawrence Krauss says something came from nothing, and he doesn't mean nothing in the philosophical sense of absolutely nothing. For example, he'll still say there was fields, for example, and quantum foam and things like that. So he doesn't really mean absolutely nothing. He meant nothing. He means nothing material. There's the material that can pop out of the energy fields, but it's like, where'd the energy fields come from? You still need something. But now the problem is, you know, the Christians will say, well, you need a God. Well, God is still this. Where did God come from? This, you can't escape that. You can't do special pleading and say, well, God just always existed. One of the problems you have with that is that, I mean, if God always existed, he's supposed to also be all-knowing. But imagine this, God can't explain where he came from because he doesn't know. He just happened to find himself always existing. And he just happens to be all-knowing and all-loving and all-powerful. It's like he didn't create himself, so he has no idea how he came to be. I mean, that's I think that's a funny outcome of it. So what are your comments on that?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, you're right about when you say that something can't come from nothing, because there's nothing in nothing to create the something, and all somethings come from something. So you're right about that. And otherwise, you get into this infinite past regression, which you just hit that point where you said, well, then where did God come from?
Well, I'll talk about the infinite regression thing, because I think there's a different answer to that. But anyway, go on.
So anyway, so therefore the conclusion is eternally existing something. There's always been something. There had to be. And that's the only logical possibility, because the alternative isn't acceptable, because you say, then what came before that? I think where the problem comes in is we're being anthropomorphic, which just basically means as humans, we're projecting our reality and our essence onto God, which, you know, I say there's the laws of physics and the laws of spirits. And so God's a spirit, so he doesn't have the same, he's not limited like we are. And, you know, of course, then I prove the Bible, and what he says in the Bible in Isaiah 46:9, he says, I am God, there is no other. I am God, there is none like me. And then in Isaiah 43:10-13, he says, before me no God was formed, and after me there shall be none. From eternity I am he. So that's the reality. That's the only logical possible conclusion. And, you know, when you say, you know, well, we can't grasp that, what's basically being said there is we're having a feeling like that doesn't make sense to us. We can't relate to that. But that feeling is coming from a human body and a human mind. So therefore, that feeling is irrelevant to reality.
So what do you think about, I mean, how did God, so you believe God always eternally existed, right?
Right.
So imagine for a second you're God, okay?
Okay.
You've got to be thinking, how did I come to be here, always existing? I mean, how did this happen? He didn't do it himself because he didn't make himself. How did he just always happen to be there?
Well, like I'm saying, where that question is coming from within you is within your from your body and your brain, your mind.
Yeah.
See? But that's human. See, so you can't project, I mean, God is much more than human. And then he states right in the Bible what I read, and
well, I'm just trying to understand it. I mean, I'm just trying to say, is there a reason to, is this understandable? Are you just trying to say it's not intelligible? It's not understandable? Is that all you're
well,
trying to
yeah,
say?
Let me give some examples of things that can be real, but that can't be grasped. For instance, can a tree grasp comedy? No, it's just like it just floats in the air around the tree. Can a paramecium grasp romance? No. Can a blind person from birth grasp color? No. Yet comedy, color, and romance do exist on a certain level and in a certain way.
Okay, but wait, yeah, but we do have logic and reason, and we use it a lot in civilization. So trying to apply logic and reason to the situation, I think, are you just saying that we can't apply it?
Well, that is the logic. I just did apply it.
No, you're saying your logic is that we can't understand it, I guess.
Yeah, that we can't grasp it.
Because we're too feeble-minded.
Well, no, it's just like I just gave three examples of realities that exist, even though certain things can't grasp their reality. Well, this is just one of them. As human beings, we can't grasp this reality. Yet it's the only logical possibility.
But I'm saying it's not logical. It's not logical to think that there's something that just found himself to be always existing. You're saying that's logical. How is it logical?
Because it's reality. It's the only possibility. It's the only logical possibility.
That's called begging the question when you say it's reality, because we're trying to figure out if God is reality, and you're saying because it's reality, it's just the way it is.
No, I'm saying it's the only logical possibility that there has to be an eternally existing something, because something doesn't come from nothing.
Okay, so let me back up a little bit and talk about this infinite regression. So what sometimes people say is that, okay, to get to this moment, we had to have a prior moment. And to get to that moment, you had to have a prior moment. And if you can't have an eternal past, because you could never find that prior moment if it keeps on escaping you, basically. So therefore, there had to be a beginning at some point in time. And I think that's okay. But I believe this universe could have came from something else. And let me give an example. For example, if you look at a person's growth from an embryo to being born to be an old person, you can observe a person through their life, and you can say, like, okay, I know this guy when he's 50. I knew this guy when he's 30. I knew this guy when he's 10. I knew this guy when he was born. I knew this guy before he was born with ultrasound. But at some point, you know, you can go back to when the egg and the sperm both joined. Okay, that was the first time that DNA came together, two sets of chromosomes. But if you go before that, there's an egg and a sperm. There was not that person. There's something different, but yet there was a history prior to that. In the same way, this universe could have came, you know, there's multiverse theory. There could be some kind of other natural realm out there. Maybe time started at the creation of this universe, maybe not. I don't think scientists are unanimous that time began at the Big Bang. I don't think that's a settled point. But time could have started at the Big Bang, but it could have came from something else, just like an embryo comes from two different things.
I agree.
So
it came from God. It came from a spiritual realm.
Yeah, but see, I think the problem there is you're jumping to magical thinking where it's like, well, we don't have the answer, so therefore magic is the best answer.
Well, no, I wouldn't say it that way. I'd say it this way, that you know, physicality, okay, the first law of thermodynamics says that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, and that includes mass. Mm-hmm. So if it can't be created, the tag on that line would be it can't be created by something physical, see? So the conclusion there is that means something non-physical had to create the initial physicality.
But that law is also just for closed systems, and the universe doesn't have to be closed at all. For example, if there's multiverse theory, there's no closed universe.
Well, yeah, the multiverse in this case would be spirit. But the thing
I'm just saying more natural.
Okay, in a more natural way of looking at it, I would say that it's a closed system in the sense that energy or mass has never been observed to spontaneously combust or to come about new from nothing.
Okay, so we're going to leave it there because we're out of time on this segment, and we've got about 5 minutes left. So I want to just have a general chit-chat on, we could just summarize. And so, I mean, from our discussion today, what did you think was, you know, do you have any follow-on? Is there anything you wanted to say that you didn't have time to say or anything?
Oh, yeah.
What do you want to say about this?
Okay, yeah, just on a personal level. Okay, Augustine said, our hearts are restless until they rest in thee. So I had a restless heart for many years, so I searched and tried out 20 different approaches to lifestyle and truth. But I didn't find rest until I found harmony with God's Spirit within me and was able to prove that it, in fact, was God's Spirit, as well as the Bible being all true. And that rest has lasted for 33 years now, and the proof just keeps getting more extensive. Based on Bible study all those years, as well as an education in science, and a number of years of daily Psalm 4:4 meditation, which I talked about. So my conclusion, and really advice to anyone, is that following the Bible is the best way to go in this life, and that I encourage people to spend some time researching it and not having a quick, you know, opinion about it. You know, and I'm saying that you'll find something that is the most beautiful, that idealism is alive, and our eternity depends on it. You know, whatever we conclude, we're all going to die. So whatever we conclude about this is going to come to reality at the point of our death. So I think we should, you know, invest a little time into, you know, investigating this.
Well, Dennis, I got to say, I you know, I appreciate that you tried all these different religions and everything, but I personally think the problem that you have is that you need to just to be, you know, I don't mean this in a negative way, but I mean, I think you're scientifically naive. And by that, I mean that, you know, you think the Earth is only about 6,000 years old, and you don't...
Which I prove.
And you don't accept evolution, which is a scientific fact that
which
humans evolved
prove.
From other animals.
See, I think that you fall into the problem of what Louis Pasteur said, a little bit of science averts us from God, but a lot of it brings us back to him. And I have availed myself to a lot of it. So, and this is the conclusion I come to. I mean, I didn't start out saying, oh, I'm going to get into the Bible and I just want to prove that the Bible is true. Mm-hmm. No, I started out open-minded. It's just, this is where it just happened to lead. And it's based on a lot of science.
Right, but you know, like, Like I said, when I prayed about the Book of Mormon, if I didn't have the knowledge about the history of Mormonism and all the things I studied about Mormonism, if I didn't have that, I would have fell for the emotions. I would have fell for it. And my understanding is what kept me back. And so, you know, I think that's the problem that you have, is that you need more scientific understanding so you don't fall for all these logical fallacies I believe that lead you.
I would say that's the case for you, you know, that you need more scientific investigation.
So you think if I learn more science, I'm going to discover that that evolution never happened, that humans never evolved from other animals. You think more science is going to show me that humans were made by what you call poof, the poof proof, right?
Yeah. You'll find out that the Bible is true, and that modern theory, modern scientific theory, is not about evolution and
modern,
what it's based on.
In modern genomics, they study all these different organisms, all these different plants and animals to see how they're all related through descent. And the more I study in science, you're going to tell me that I'm going to see how more all of that is fallacious.
Well, no. I mean, as far as the genome, I mean, first of all, 70% we have in common with, say, apes. Okay? Well, I mean, it's obvious that we have that. We both have eyes. We both have hands. We both breathe. We both eat food. We both digest. So there's a lot in common. But what animals don't have is a spirit. See, and see, the Bible even says that that God breathed a soul not only into human beings, you know, but He gave a soul to animals too, and that's the thing that moves us, you know. But only human beings have a spirit.
Okay, you're saying all animals also have a cell? I mean, a soul?
Yeah.
Even ants?
That's what the Bible says. Yeah.
Even ants?
Yeah.
Even single cell amoebas?
I don't know about that. I have to think about the whole plant life and everything, because plants were made for us to eat right from the beginning.
But see, that's the thing about life, is there's such a gradation. There's such, I mean, all the way down from single cell creatures to, you know, we're very complex multi-cell creatures. So when you say, you know, something like all animals have a soul, you got to have to somehow figure out a dividing line. I mean, you're going to have spiders and mosquitoes and everything with souls, and even germs and bacteria, and you know, you got to figure out where the dividing line is there.
Well, the dividing line is laid out in the Bible. It says basically that just man has a spirit, and all these things. See, you got to look at, it's even down to the atomic level. All that stuff moves by itself. Well, what propels it? Something had to set it in motion.
Okay. Well, okay, I guess we're going to have to stop there because we're out of time. Dennis, I want to say I really appreciate you. Thank you for coming on the show. Thank you for talking about this, because I think we're talking about some important things that a lot of churches don't talk about, because it's just maybe they see it's too controversial or something. And I'm an atheist. There's going to be probably atheists who see this and think I do a real sucky job. There's going to be Christians who say, of course, you misrepresent Christianity. I misrepresent atheism, so we're both misrepresenting our sides, you know, just as well, I guess. So, thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah, thank you. And by the way, you know, you're right. This is important stuff, and pursue the truth. That's what we're both doing, and that's what everybody should do.
And that's one thing we both strongly agree on, is that we should seek the truth with all our heart and mind. Okay, thanks again, Dennis.
Thank you.
All right, good night.
Good night.